YouTube, what's going on? It's Mesa Sean back at it with some Destiny 2. All right, folks, strap in. We have a ton of Destiny 2 Forsaken news to go over in this video, and all of it is coming from Game Informer. Now, the 2018 August issue of Game Informer, their cover story is Destiny 2 Forsaken. Since I am a digital subscriber to it, I have the whole thing downloaded, and we're going to go over it in detail in this video. Now, there will be a few spoilers here and there, so if you want to click off now, but make sure you hit that like button before you leave the video. Let's get into this, guys. The first thing I want to cover before we get into the meat and potatoes of the article is a quick video that Game Informer put up today, basically plugging that they will be covering Destiny 2 Forsaken all of the month of August. They got to play, they got to talk to the developers, and so forth. But in that video, we do see a quick clip of what looks like to be Escalation Protocol is coming with Forsaken, and this one's going to be a new one. We see on screen it says, The Blind Well, Tier 1, defeat enemies to charge the well. Light deposited, 24%. Now we see five different icons here, so it looks like five different levels of enemies. So maybe this is Escalation Protocol that's new, but with maybe some objectives thrown in, rather than just killing everything. I don't know, we'll have to see. We also get to see a clip of a new exotic auto rifle called the Cerebrus Plus One. As you can see in the clip, this is kinetic, or in your primary slot. They say here, this wild new exotic auto rifle is inspired by the Contra spread gun, and it is really four different barrels all strapped together into one Frankenstein of a weapon. Cerebrus Plus One shoots out in four directions at once, so it can be devastating in the right circumstances, especially if you can line up your distance from target with multiple bullet streams. We'll have an in-depth look at this new exotic at GameInforma.com. So let's talk about how Forsaken is going to kick off. So some things I will paraphrase, some things I will read verbatim. Let me read you this verbatim. The Prison Riot mission that opens up the campaign and precedes Cade's death sets the stakes. Through a surprising array of cinematic cutscenes and bombastic descent into the heart of the Prison of Elders, the solar system's worst criminals are set loose, even as Cade and my guardian try to stem the tide. At our side is Petra Venge, our connection to the mysterious Awoken race that has lived through the reef at the asteroid belt. After we are separated, Cade reaches the lowest depths of the facility first and encounters the real cause of the uproar. Presumed dead by many, we see a face that has been absent in the story since the beginning of the Taken King. The sullen Awoken Prince Aldrin has been imprisoned deep within the Prison of Elders and now stands at the head of an army of creatures twisted from the fallen into a new breed of enemy called the Scorn. Now let's talk about the Scorn for a little bit. They're not just reskins of fallen, folks. They're pretty different. It says here, while they were once fallen, corrupted ether, suffering through strange experiments, repeated reanimations, and being buried alive in the heart of an asteroid has mutated these enemies. They are this group that was locked into the deepest parts of the Prison of Elders. They have become something horrible because of that situation. They bonded and mutated within these dark caverns. They're like an evolution of the fallen if you stuck them in a corner, kind of like animals of Australia or Madagascar. Weird things develop on this tiny island, and if you constrain them from any other influence. So let's talk about some of the different types of the Scorn. It says here, every subtype of Scorn is fundamentally new and demand new strategies to confront. Hulking mongrels tower over the battlefield, blasting out cascades of lightning that are nearly impossible to dodge. Arachnid-like Screeb scramble on all fours in packs, bloated with dark ether, exploding themselves with a detonation range that puts cursed hive thralls to shame. Then we have Scorn Raiders. So the Raiders send out spinning explosive saw blades of void energy and disappear into ethereal streams of light to teleport across the field. Then we have these Scorn Lurkers. So the Scorn Lurkers carry small, circular, gladiator-like shields that stubbornly block my shots until I stagger them with a leg wound. And he says his personal favorite were the Ravengers. The Ravengers are these hunchback skulkers who charge at you at first sight, spinning lantern-like sensors that slam it to the ground to create a gout of solar flame. Then we have the Chieftains, and it says here, holding them all together are the Chieftains, who introduce a new twist on fights by throwing out one of three distinct totems. Solar totems are spinning turrets of flame that act as an area denial in their radius, more than a few seconds inside a recipe for respawn. Void totems create an invulnerable shield to all enemies in medium range. When it shows up, other priority targets must take a backseat until I blow them up. Arc totems are the most insidious. If one hits near me, it rubber bands my guardian back towards it, and it is impossible to escape unless it's destroyed, even as other Scorn are charging my location. They also say basically that they are very aggressive, the Scorn. They don't retreat, they don't go for cover, they're just constantly trying to kill you. Now we finally have details on all of the 9 supers, and I'm sure as Game Informer continues to cover this in August, we'll see more gameplay. So let's kick this off with the Titan. The Sentinel is getting what's called Code of the Commander. Melees cause explosions, but all void ability damage also attaches a void detonator, and any subsequent damage causes the detonator to go off and attach detonators to enemies caught in the explosion. Grenade energy partially recharges for you and nearby allies when the detonators trigger. With the super, you also have Banner Shield. So Banner Shield can still be used for offense like normal, but holding guard creates a barrier wall of light that absorbs enemy attacks, but also allows ally attacks to pass through that shield. The Funbreaker is getting what's called Code of the Devastator. Throw your hammer with the melee button, but it remains in the world. Risk retrieving it where it fell to fully recharge your melee ability and trigger health regeneration. The more solar ability kills you get, the higher your damage up to 3 times. Siege Hammer creates a flaming maul that hits like an earthquake and leaves behind flame tornadoes. Now, the Striker Titan gets Code of the Missile, which I've shown you gameplay of before when I went to record this stuff at E3. So for Code of the Missile, while airborne, melee to slam into the ground like a bunker buster and gain super energy for your trouble. If you pick up ammo while sliding, you're automatically reloading your equipped weapon and increase weapon damage for a short time. Then you have Thunder Crash. Sends you hurtling through great distances like a missile to hit a targeted area like a meteor strike. Moving on to the Warlock, the Voidwalker is getting Attunement of Fission. A new Atomic Breach melee ability creates a void explosion at range. While holding the grenade button down, creates a short-range area explosion supernova. Any void ability kills now heal you and grant ability energy. Next up, we have Nova Warp. Empowers you with trans-dimensional hopping abilities, letting you repeatedly teleport short distances and then erupt in a burst of energy. The Stormcaller is getting Attunement of Control. Tap the melee button to fling out a long-distance electricity ball that eventually detonates and flings out a lightning bolt straight downward. Arc kills sometimes create ionic traces, a spark of raw arc energy that travels across the ground towards you, which can be collected to recharge your abilities. Then we have Chaos Reach. So a Chaos Reach, it's going to fire a long-range blue beam of intense and focused damage dealing, which can be deactivated early to save some energy. Now the Dawnblade, I have some footage of this in the background. You get Attunement of Grace. Melee attacks burn bad guys, but empowers allies. Transform your grenade by holding down the button into a blessing, a projectile that heals allies and drops retrievable overshield orbs. Then you have Well of Radiance. Slam your solar sword into the ground, creating a wide radius aura that rapidly heals and empowers your friends. Any ability that heals or empowers helps regen your non-super abilities. Next up for the Hunter, we have the Night Stalker Way of the Wraith. So your melee smoke bomb heavily damages and slows those in its path. Nail the perfect precision kill against a foe to vanish and gain True Sight. That's the wall hacking where you can see through walls. Spectral Blades. That's going to drop you into a veil of shadows to slip behind foes and stab them before they know you're even there. Now the Gunslinger gets Way of a Thousand Cuts. So knife trick melees fling out a fan of burning blades. In turn, killing burning enemies recharges your knife trick, and burning enemies also recharge your dodge. You also get what's called Blade Barrage. Doubles down on your knife skills to expel a volley of explosive knives. The Arc Strider gets what's called Way of the Current. So slide before a melee to unleash a staff-powered uppercut, and any melee hits increases your reload speed, all of your arc abilities, electrify your enemies, and subsequent melee strikes disorient them and refuel your abilities. Use your staff super like normal if desired, but you have what's called Whirlwind Guard. So Whirlwind Guard means that you can guard by spinning your staff, reflecting back projectiles, and tripling your staff's damage afterward. So let's talk a little bit about the Tangled Shore. We have two destinations with Forsaken, the Tangled Shore and then also the Dreaming City. The Dreaming City is where the raid is going to be and also most of the end, well, I think all of the end game content. So let me read you some quotes about the Tangled Shore. So the new destination is a long-awaited opportunity for players to explore the mysteries of the reef. The asteroids are pockmarked with caves, ramshackle pirate bases, and hidden shortcuts. Fallen scavengers do battle against their mutated Scorn cousins. A crashed tomb ship swarms with Hive. Remnants of the Red Legion scramble for territory. In the distance, a majestic awoken watchtower looms over the area, promising lost secrets. High Moon Studios partnered with Bungie not only to make the Scorn, but also to bring life this chaotic new reef destination. They said they wanted to tell a Western. We came down to the phrase that in the heat of what we were trying to accomplish, brave the lawless frontier. That was the core of the story, stepping beyond the reach of the Vanguard, going into a place that is not sanctioned by Zavala, where you can trust no one. Now, like all destinations, we have a new NPC, and the NPC for the Tangled Shore is simply called the Spider. Let me read you this here. Descending past the hidden smuggler's caches, I meet the Spider. This fallen mob boss once held sway over the Tangled Shore, but the arrival of Aldrin sent him into hiding. Not only is the Spider the vendor for the destination, but an uneasy alliance with him and his fallen forces gives me the only help I can expect this far out from the Vanguard. Now, his enforcers often accompany me on subsequent adventures, lending support while rarely wading into the most dangerous confrontations. Early on, he wants these new invaders dealt with. After the campaign, he cashes in favors to demand yet more work, hunting down other outlaws from the Prison of Elders as they spread across the system, where I must confront them as they appear in random world locations, strikes in the midst of a gambit match, or revitalized and high-level lost sectors on old destination planets. So it looks like some of these, well, some of the new enemies, they're going to be on the other destinations, not just over on the Tangled Shore. Now, before we can work with this Spider, we have to finish the campaign, and that involves hunting down these barons. Now, there is a lot of information regarding how the campaign plays out. I'm not going to go over that with you guys, okay? If you want to read about it yourself, you have to go find this article or be a subscriber to GameInformer.com. Let's move on and learn about weapon slots. So here are some more details. Let's talk about ammo first. So, ammo type is no longer directly tied to weapon slots. Instead, ammo type dictates the power of the weapon and the relative rarity of finding that ammo type. Weapons using primary white and special green ammo can show up in either kinetic or energy slot. A weapon in the power slot still always will use the heavy purple ammo. Many weapon archetypes have moved out of the power slot, and these weapons can now appear in either the kinetic or the energy weapon slot. Individual weapons always drop into a specific slot. For example, Hawthorne's Field Forge shotgun has become a kinetic weapon and is always found in that slot. Rare exceptions sometimes is going to break the rules and show up in a different slot or with alternate ammo. For example, an especially powerful bow might use green ammo, or some shotguns, like the Legend of Acrius, might be so strong that they sit in the power slot. So let's go through some examples they have here of the different types of weapons. So let's say for auto rifles, bows, hand cannons, pulse rifles, scout rifles, sidearms, and submachine guns, these weapons are found in the kinetic or the energy slot, and they're going to use primary white ammo. Next up, we have breech-loaded grenade launchers, fusion rifles, shotguns, sniper rifles, and trace rifles. These weapons are found in the kinetic or energy slot, but they're going to use green ammo. Now, for drum-loaded grenade launchers, linear fusion rifles, rocket launchers, and swords, they're going to be found in the power slot and use purple heavy ammo. Now, this is going to do it for this video, guys. This thing could go on for about 30 minutes, so I'm going to make a second video tomorrow that's going to go into the rest of this article. We're going to learn about the Dreaming City, a lot about the Dreaming City. Also, a really good sit down with Christopher Barrett, and also just tons of details about refreshing the hobby and how Destiny 2 Forsaken is going to all pan out. So leave me a hashtag made it to the end if you did make it to the end, and do me a favor, drop a like in this video only if you see fit. Follow me on the Twitter at Mesa Sean. Check out my stream, usually and always on YouTube, and that is it. I am out of here like Vladimir.